Hello there, and welcome to The Value of Everything. I'm pleased to have Michael Acuna back with me for a dialogue. We hope to get another installment of our debate out as soon as we can. So as a filler in between that gap, we have produced this episode where we cover the topics of Brexit, Enoch Powell on mass migration, Oswald Mosley and fascism. We compare fascism to communism and the political spectrums. Finally, the media's portrayal of the left. You can find Michael at commonruin.wordpress.com. Please consider liking, subscribing, or sharing, and let us know your thoughts. So let me now pass you over. We're going to step straight into me questioning Michael on the Brexit. With the situation with Europe, and particularly more focused on the UK, if there is a hard exit, how would you see particularly the labour market and youth labour being affected? So the fact that the UK has got extremely low interest rates, really a situation where they've got a lot of public debt, which they don't really want to raise interest rates on, as well as private debt, so housing debt. And you've got a situation where their currency might depreciate quite rapidly, and that would create some kind of inflation. Is there an advantage whereby a certain market's going to be cut off or restricted for a short space of time? That marketplace had a lot of barriers to entry, and then there might still remain some kind of demand in the domestic market. There's like a liberalization factor. There's still demand, but obviously you've got the penalties of a currency depreciating at the same time. So there's a lot of factors at play, and that's why I don't see necessarily any major commentators mentioning what's going to happen with a hard Brexit. It'll be just fascinating to just get a Marxist's opinion of what lies ahead.
Well, I think I should preface my comments by just saying that there's no telling what the Brexit situation is going to precipitate in the long run. There was a lot of fear mongering all the way up into the referendum by pro-European analysts that were just threatening utter chaos and mismanagement and fiasco in the labor market and in exports as a consequence of a Brexit vote. And none of that came to pass. They were threatening that this would happen within a couple of months of the decision if it went in that direction, and none of it has happened.
Yeah.
So far, things have been relatively stable. Let's just say that there is a hard exit, and it does have some deleterious consequences. There's so many variables and so many facets that one has to consider. Just examining where the United Kingdom stands now vis-a-vis the rest of the world in exports. I mean, ever since the Thatcher regime, the UK hasn't really been manufacturing that much. The economy now is more orientated around services, and specifically financial services in the City of London. I don't foresee much in the way of finance deviating to other parts of Europe. I mean, London has already built up a financial infrastructure that a lot of Europeans and people around the world rely on. It's analogous to New York City in that respect. And I don't see that really changing much.
Yep.
They do export agricultural product. I think that that will remain relatively unaffected. Usually when it comes to trade, agriculture is a stable export. Even if they don't export as much to Europe, they can still rely on Commonwealth countries. I think that that should be unaffected. One of the more interesting components of Brexit, however, would be the domestic labor market, and particularly no longer having to abide by the freedom of movement for labor stipulation that the European Union has. So there's going to be far less in the way of Eastern European immigration into the UK. And that will help the domestic working class of the UK in terms of the wages they receive. Now, as a Marxist, you have to think of everything you don't have to, but I think it's helpful to think of things dialectically. So on the one hand, employers in the UK will have to hire domestically, and their domestic working class has a higher standard of living and higher expectations in terms of remuneration. So they're going to have to pay more to labor. So wages are going to go up. But anytime you have an increase in the cost of labor, then you have to think of what the repercussions could be. And since capitalism is a system geared around profit maximization, you might start seeing sluggish investment in certain sectors of the economy because they're paying more in terms of labor cost. Obviously, as a communist, I always support whatever happens to maximize labor share of the product. But you can't be naive. You have to analyze what can follow. And that might have negative consequences in terms of employment. If there's less reinvestment, fewer people are going to be employed, or they're going to reinvest more in capital goods, automating systems. It's the same as when you increase the minimum wage, let's say. That's something that follows from it. But it's hard to predict how this is going to go. Personally, just as a matter of principle, I'm glad that the UK voted to leave the European Union in the referendum. And I do think overall it's going to benefit the working class, because they'll have more autonomy over decisions that are made in the United Kingdom. They don't have to worry about interference from Brussels, but it's hard to really predict much of the economic fallout might be. Personally, I'm of the opinion that it's going to be less severe than a lot of the Europhiles are contending.
Are you quite familiar with the UK Labour Party and Jeremy Corbyn?
Oh, yes. I've been following that pretty closely.
Okay. So just as a little quick background, so the Labour Party was pretty much taken over by the corporatocracy with when it started to become New Labour and run by Tony Blair. It did seem to be that they had a lot more interest in really being a more of a centre to centre right party, and really didn't isolate any of the arguments for the labour market, and really never spoke against the corporate class. Now, Jeremy Corbyn has been on the backbenches in that parliament for ages, and he's like a socialist, basically. And he's actually risen to the power by the grassroots. Now, a lot of people say that he's a little bit challenged by the amount that he's offering for the cost that it's going to take for the UK economy. It's a really interesting situation. Every time there's a vote in to kick him out, some of the benchers want to get rid of him because they're still part of that New Labour sort of sense under Tony Blair. But he still remains, because on a grassroots level, they know what he stands for.
Mm-hmm.
He's pretty much held into power. But they still don't seem to be like really smashing it when it comes to the polls. So do you see anything materialising for the Labour Party movement in the UK? Do you think that's going through a transition, or do you think that's just going to whimper out and die?
I think that it has potential, but I don't know if Jeremy Corbyn is the individual that can really take advantage of the momentum there. I think that, you know, he's a relic of old Labour. What he's proposing is, at least in relative terms, socialistic, especially when compared to, you know, the Blairite segment of the Labour Party, which is hegemonic for the most part. His supporters in the party are rather marginal, but nevertheless, Labour Party members are enthusiastic about Corbyn in particular. But I think that his appeal on the general population isn't as strong as it otherwise could be. And I think that has a lot to do with Corbyn's espousal of controversial positions in terms of identity politics and immigration. And this is a problem across the center-left spectrum. It's, you know, Bernie Sanders had the same issue in the United States. I think that he's signaling towards positions that don't resonate with the population at large. And it doesn't have to do with economic policy. It has more to do with cultural issues and migration, and migration does have an economic consequence. Let's make no mistake about that.
Yeah.
But Corbyn has been supportive of the free movement of labor, and workers instinctually know that that's problematic for themselves. Like, that's increasing, it's saturating the labor market, putting downward pressure on wages, making it more competitive. That's not a position one should uphold if one is interested in gaining a mass movement. And yet we see not just center-left parties, but people in the contemporary left in general, even radicals, have adopted this position, which I've always been perplexed by, because it's just fundamentally at odds with basic labor market analysis. Historically, Marxists had opposed it for the most part. It's only in recent post-68 that we started seeing this shift in sympathies.
Yeah. I've got to ask you this question as well, because I've been following, I feel like, a little bit like a creep again, following sort of like the nasty people in British political history. I've been looking at Mosley and Enoch Powell. Are you familiar with those two people?
Oh, yes. I read several biographies of Oswald Mosley in the past. Enoch Powell, I know a little bit about, not nearly as much as Mosley, but I am familiar with his history.
I did an episode recently about Enoch Powell. He did a speech about the Rivers of Blood, pretty much classed as like a racist speech, and he really was cast to one side. However, when you look him up and you listen to him talk, he's actually like a real traditional old-style politician. It's like your Greek philosopher kind of style, where he's looking at a couple of steps ahead of society and culture, really weighing up the whole scenario, making future predictions and taking a stand for a particular position.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really interesting how he actually used hyperbole. He did actually say in his speech in the Rivers of Blood, where he quoted one of his constituents mentioning that the whip hand would be passed from the white man to the black man. And this is a story about where his constituent said that he doesn't want to live in the UK anymore because he feels like there's a mass immigration coming into his country, and he's got three kids of his own, but it really isn't showing, all this like high migration, and the country that he fought for isn't really the same again.
Yeah.
And then he goes into other stories about a woman who's a landlady, and the community's just pretty much changed very rapidly. And she chose to refuse migrants, and then she was victimized for choosing not to allow migrants in. But basically, the Rivers of Blood speech sort of encapsulates him saying that my constituents are saying this, and to ignore this is really a very sad thing for politics. I should be able to mention this to people. And I guess the main message from Enoch Powell is that mass migration leads to segregation. I would say that I would agree with that. If you get migration on a sort of a trickle level, then people can integrate very well into society. But if you have mass migration, then there's going to be, there isn't necessarily any kind of impulse or motivation for you to really work to integrate into that society. So there's that part. And basically, when he put out his message, he got a massive popular position, and he's a conservative as well, so on the right side. A lot of the dockers and, like, you know, a lot of the union people, your market porters and stuff, leapt to support him and did a massive march to say that we want him in power. If there was a presidential situation in the UK, he could have risen to power quite easily, but because there's more of a party toe-in-the-line sort of politics situation, Ted Heath expelled him from the shadow cabinet at that time. And then you've got Oswald Mosley. He seems to, I don't like him as much, really. I think he's a very dodgy person who's really, he's a clever, crafty kind of guy who sort of takes opportunity in situations. And it seems like he, you know, like where a lot of these leaders, like even Hitler, was an actor and he's trying to copy people of the past. That's very particular with Mosley, I find.
Yeah.
Obviously, he is demonstrating that he wants one very strong political party. He wants to represent the nation, and he gets a massive following of the trade unions. The trade unions, again, love him for that protectionist of the national class of society. Although I don't think he really represented merging all the classes. It was more fascism, which is isolating all into one nation. I think he still stood by a class tier system, but all are inside one nation.
Right.
So I just wanted to get your thoughts of that. Like, because everyone says there is that little connection where the trade union might follow the fascist every once in a while, just because of the uniting under one nation rather than uniting under the labor class.
Yeah, yeah. Focusing on Enoch Powell for a moment, I remember listening to the Rivers of Blood speech years ago, just because it's one of those pivotal political speeches in contemporary history that had major repercussions, and it reflected the sign of the times. Enoch Powell was a traditional conservative, so he was chiefly concerned with the cultural implications of mass migration. However, he also was astute enough to understand its effect on the labor market, and he was able to capture working class support because so many British proletarians were experiencing anxiety over mass migration for material and for cultural reasons. We can't ever just separate that entirely. I mean, that's obviously a concern amongst workers as it is anyone. So he was able to capitalize on that. And I think he genuinely, you know, harbored those feelings. He wasn't doing it cynically or anything like that. Again, he was a traditional conservative. But what was interesting was that sort of marginalized him among Tories, because there was a division that started emerging around that time where you had more liberal, and I mean it in terms of market liberalism, not in terms of social liberalism.
Yeah.
But also even in terms of social liberalism. In the Tory party, there was a liberal contingent that was gaining momentum, and it was sort of becoming hegemonic in the party. And that sort of was finally came to a head with the election of Thatcher, where they started setting aside cultural concerns and started emphasizing more liberal economics.
There's no such thing as community.
Right.
That's what
right.
Thatcher said.
Exactly. This hyper-individualism. And so he was at odds with that segment of the party, and he became marginalized afterwards. Now, in terms of him being racist, I mean, I think that he was. I'm pretty sure he used the expression "pickaninny," which is sort of a racial slur against black people. They were cotton pickers, and pickaninny was a way to denigrate them. So I think he harbored racist sentiments. But then again, so many politicians in every party back then held racist sympathies. So it was very casual. It wasn't anything that was unique to Powell.
I think it's a very tricky thing to say, because somebody that's like middle of the road today is very different to somebody that was middle of the road back in those times, kind of thing.
Right.
So somebody that's very sort of not too biased or anything like that. Okay, so with Enoch Powell, he actually, he's probably one of the most brightest politicians the UK's ever had. He was the youngest professor in the British Empire ever. He studied ancient Greek, and he was a professor in Sydney University. In the Second World War, he rised up through the ranks from just your normal soldier all the way up to brigadier, which was unheard of as well. So absolutely like top of the top in terms of quality intellect. And he, even when he was working in India, he actually was really in awe of India. He actually loved Indian culture and stuff, and he actually wrote books on it and how much he appreciated it and stuff. But possibly under the English-British colonialism sort of perspective, I don't know. We don't know necessarily how the world was a totally different situation back in those days.
Yeah.
The interesting thing was when the British Empire started to break down, there was all these different situations that happened where a lot of countries were part of the British Empire, and really The problem was is that you had your direct Connollys, which were, let's say, your Canadas, your Australias, your New Zealands and stuff. But then you had like your non-direct Connollys, which were your like Indias and stuff, which massive populations. And the problems were is that if you try and class everybody as a British citizen of the empire, then you create this situation of mass migration. So there had to be a certain situation of distinguishing between the two, because you would just create this incredible amount of migration. Now, the problem was is there was certain refugee crises which happened around the world, where you get these dictators and leaders pushing out people, and they were still subjects of the British Empire. So we would allow people asylum for these certain crises which would occur. But this is where Enoch Powell was looking at it. It says like, well, really, we need to really focus as to what we are and what this British Empire is anymore. If we're going to harbour all of these people into this very rich, wealthy country in comparison to these very poor countries, it's really not going to work after a while. So Enoch Powell is a very fascinating person. I'd definitely recommend just checking him out, because he makes some incredible predictions which come fairly true today. Even his predictions of how the migration was going to affect, if you stand that up to what London is today, with like, I think majority is born in from a foreign land and stuff like that, he makes some incredible predictions, and they come out true. And I think that's because of his very logical based thinking. He was an opportunist as well. He was using hyperbole with his speeches. And obviously, if you're going to be a good politician, you've got to make a prediction one step ahead, and then you're part of that time. It's like the Churchill phase. He's looks like a weirdo warmonger in the background saying, oh, Hitler's going to be a danger, and everyone's going, shush, we don't want a war. And then all of a sudden he kicks off with Poland, and then he looks like the person who was in the right situation at the right time, and he assumes power. So I just think that that whole scenario is very fascinating. But the way that the labor movement works around that as well, how people gear themselves and they go, okay, yeah, we don't want mass migration into this country. We do actually want a strong labor market, and we don't want this heightened competition from these other lands. There is this type of protectionism aspect. And obviously, when you think about the situation of empires is all about mercantilism, about ensuring that you've got plenty of gold, you can only trade with yourself, you're making monopolies and cartels on trading routes to ensure that you can keep the strongest empire possible. But that really all had to get demolished by the end of the First World War, really, where Britain was in decline, and the Second World War, that couldn't be managed anymore. But it's interesting how the empire destructed and the migrant crisis sort of flowed from that point.
Yeah, it's very interesting. And I think that, and I often, when I've had debates and arguments with conservatives and people on the far right, I always find it interesting how, on the one hand, they support capitalism and all of the institutions that are associated therewith. But on the other hand, because in my estimation, when we're looking at migration, and whether it be in the United Kingdom, the European mainland, or North America, for that matter, the real impetus behind it is economic. Employers want to saturate the labor market with cheap foreign labor. It's beneficial for them. They maximize profits that way. And these same companies exert inordinate influence over political matters. Now, there'll be individual politicians like Enoch Powell or Donald Trump, for instance, in the United States in a contemporary moment, who resist that. However, they're resisting the logic of the very mode of production which they're functioning within. So I always found it interesting how conservatives can, on the one hand, uphold capitalism, and then on the other hand, denounce a logical consequence of it. I mean, people, especially on the far right, they seem to have this idealistic notion where in reality, you could have a political establishment that sets up strong borders, that regulates the labor market tightly, and therefore you can mitigate the consequences of immigration. That this is just a matter of politicians trying to do good and they're following these naive humanitarian impulses. I mean, that's often what this is masked as. But if you look at who's really soliciting for immigrants, it's always large business interests.
Yeah.
That's just, you know, pleasantries that politicians use to justify it to the public, but that's just what you would expect in the situation. In other words, you have to make a different distinction between the official justification and the actual justification. And Enoch Powell, he was resisting the momentum of the times. And if we look at Oswald Mosley and fascists in particular, they often are guilty of harboring the same false notion that you can have this autonomous government that is looking out for the national interest and therefore can set limits as to what who's coming in and for what reasons. Oswald Mosley was an interesting character because, as you said, Enoch Powell sort of exemplified the traditional classical statesman. Mosley, as a politician, he had certain virtues. I think that his main virtue was just that he was an eloquent speaker. Like, even as a communist, when I listen to his speeches, I'm impressed. Yeah. I think that he was able to really galvanize people and elicit emotional response from people who listen to his speeches.
Sorry, just to interrupt you there. He actually mentioned that he studied all of the greatest orators of the past, and he tried to emulate each one of those, which is very interesting.
I mean, he spent his whole political career emulating. I mean, with his British Union of Fascists, their uniform was identical to the Italian fascists. His oration was analogous to Hitler's. He really was a good student of continental fascist aesthetics.
Yeah.
But nonetheless, that shouldn't take away from his own individual contribution there too. But as you said, he was an opportunist. He also, you know, if you follow his political trajectory, I think he started off as a Tory and then he became involved in the Labour Party.
He was one of the youngest politicians, I believe.
Yeah, yeah.
At the time.
And he formed the British Union of Fascists, and I think he was under house arrest or something for all of World War II because he actually went to Italy and Germany and collaborated with the regimes there. So he was viewed as an enemy of the state. Then after that, he never really renounced fascism, but he started dabbling in neo-fascist movements. So he was actually a proponent of a European Union of sorts. He called it Europe a Nation. So he believed in a federated Europe. And he sort of, it's interesting, he had a background in Marxism when he was in the Labour Party. I think he read Das Kapital and a few other Marxist works. And he sensed that socialism, especially after the Second World War, had purchase amongst the working class in the UK, which it did. And he tried to incorporate elements of that into his political platforms. Periodically, he supported syndicalist unions and labor-managed firms, very radical proposals. But ultimately, at the end of his life, he reverted back to his fascist corporatist economic model, which is just a state-controlled economy, but with private property, with capitalists and proletarians, and everything is regulated for the national interest, the very idealistic notion that all fascists generally support. But he was a Machiavellian. He was trying to capitalize on certain moments, and he never really had that much of a following, but he's an interesting character nonetheless.
Yeah, there's two things that just come to mind there, is that as somebody who would like an anarchic society, you do see the problem of one nation. The nation turns itself into a beast of protectionism eventually. It has to. Or it just turns into this kind of weird, wishy-washy, globalist corporatocracy. There's like some kind of yin and a yang. If anything, like sometimes people say, okay, well, there's left and right politics. You probably could make more of an argument to say there's like a nationalist versus a globalist mentality. You could make more of an argument for that kind of political. There's multi-political spectrums. You don't necessarily need to just tie up into left and right. And even left and right politics is really just a very confusing matter.
Yeah.
There's obviously similarities between fascism and communism. Not everything entirely. Obviously, it's the productive class of the workers is the isolation on the communist side, and on the fascist side, it's more like giving up oneself, the sacrifice for one's nation is the main thing. But I wouldn't necessarily say that they are the two opposite sides of the spectrum, because look, Nazis are called National Socialists. It's a unification of a sort, whereas the middle plane is like some kind of a wash where we're trying to agree to all sides.
Right. There's a lot of work in political sociology and philosophy as to where fascism lies on the political spectrum. I've always been of the opinion that, because there's different metrics that one can employ to decide where a certain movement stands on the political spectrum. On the one hand, we have to look at authoritarianism versus libertarianism.
Yep.
In government. And then on the other hand, we have to look at the economic policies. I'm of the opinion that fascism is clearly an authoritarian movement, avowedly so. That's one of its raison d'etre, is authoritarianism. They believe that the masses need paternalistic guidance in a certain direction.
It always needs a very charismatic leader.
Right, right. Communism, the difference is that even though there have been regimes historically that were very statist, like the Soviet Union or Maoist China, they never justified it on its own terms. They never said that authoritarianism was inherently good. They always had to come up with an excuse as to why it needed to be employed. And they always tried to emphasize that it was only temporary. Fascists made no such pretenses. So that's one element that sort of distinguishes them. Now, when it comes to economic policy, fascism is what I regard as a centrist ideology. So the difference between fascism and National Socialism on the one hand and then communism on the other is that fascists, they believe that classes are just a natural consequence of human nature. However, that capitalism, when you have a liberal market economy, then you have abuse, that the capitalists abuse the working class, and that this can be mitigated when you have a fascist state that's looking out for the national interest.
Yes.
They can regulate the economy in such a way that all parties benefit.
The fascists and the communists, even though they always are at war with each other, I don't know why, but they're united in going against the corporatocracy, which is, I always find kind of funny in that respect.
Yeah, well, the history of antagonism between communists and fascists is very old. Interestingly enough, a lot of people don't realize this, but Benito Mussolini himself had been a Marxist in the beginning of his career. He was in the Italian Socialist Party. He was even a member of the far left contingent of that party.
Doesn't surprise me.
He was initially radically opposed to the Italian Empire and their involvement in the First World War, but he started, honestly, I'm of the opinion that Mussolini, sort of like Oswald Mosley, and he was an opportunist. He was very Machiavellian, even as a communist. And so he was looking at where the momentum was at any given moment, and he was trying to carve out a niche for himself. So he noticed that sentiment for the war was on the rise. So even as a socialist, he started supporting Italian involvement in the First World War. And that's when he was sort of ejected from the party, because at least the Italian Socialist Party took a strong anti-war position. So after the war, he started warming up to business interests in Italy. And there was I'm sort of going over a lot of history in a really short time span.
That's fine.
But
that's good.
In Italy, after the First World War, there was this huge resurgence in proletarian militancy. They called it the Biennio Rosso, which means in English, the two red years. Communist parties, socialist parties were ascending strikes were ubiquitous, and then workers actually started occupying factories and appropriating means of production, and it was getting very radical. And Mussolini, one of the first uses of his fascist party, or the proto elements of the fascist party, the black shirts and the fascisti, or no, the squadristi rather, they actually went to farms and businesses that had been appropriated by their workers, went into them, physically assaulted the workers that were there, and gave the property back to the owners. And then it was a very violent period, and eventually there was the March on Rome when Mussolini was appointed chancellor, and that's where the hostility between communists and fascists initially started. In Germany, it was similar. The history of National Socialism is a bit more complicated, because within the National Socialist Party, before they came to power, there was an element of the party that was more radical than the Hitlerite faction. They were the Strasserist faction, led by Gregor Strasser, and they supported more conventional socialist policies like nationalizing major institutions, profit sharing, agrarian reform, those sort of things. And the Hitlerite party didn't believe in that, or the Hitlerite segment of the party was opposed to that on principle. And I would regard Hitler as more of a genuine ideologue than Mussolini was. Like, Hitler had an entire worldview based around social Darwinism and archaic race theories that he was trying to follow. Economics was just incidental to him. But for Mussolini, I think it was certainly more so him just trying to seize the moment, as he saw, and whatever could aggrandize him more. But yeah, so there's a complicated history, but it ultimately boils down to fascists banning other parties, which would include communist parties, and fascists supporting in principle the institution of private property and basic market social relations, which communists oppose adamantly. So that's what really distinguishes them. Now,
just to interrupt you there, just if a business is very corporatist or something like that, then a fascist would turn it over to work for the national interest. They'll basically make it a public company.
Well, that's interesting, because on the for instance, in Germany, on the 25-point program, that was one of the points that they said that they were going to do. So if a company was deemed to be operating against the national interest, it would be nationalized. In reality, they only did that a few times in Germany, and that was during the Second World War. So they nationalized a airplane manufacturing plant and one other company. Usually what they do, as opposed to nationalizing it, they would just install a business owner. They would take possession of it, or they would put someone on the board of directors that was sympathetic to the regime. So they would sort of stack the deck in their favor. They didn't actually nationalize that much. In fact, when the Nazis first took office, they privatized a lot of what the Social Democrats had nationalized, interestingly enough. But to one last interesting historical point that a lot of people on the left aren't aware of, let alone people on the right, during Mussolini's last couple of years in power, after they were already losing the Second World War and the fascists had done a coup d'etat against Mussolini himself, he had a puppet regime in the north of Italy called Salo, the Salo Republic. And in that regime, which was sort of like a Nazi puppet state, he was only there because the Nazis were securing the terrain for him. He actually brought on board a couple of his old comrades from when he was still a socialist. One of them, whose name is Nicola Bombassi, he was one of the foremost Marxist theoreticians in Italy prior to the First World War. He was a founding member of the Italian Communist Party. He actually was brought into the Salo regime, and he drafted what was called the Charter of Verona, which was a labor charter. And he basically was supporting the socialization of the means of production to be put under workers' control, which is very classic communist demand. And Mussolini is the one who encouraged him to do this. Now, none of that was ever really instituted because they lost the war and Mussolini was captured by Italian partisans and he was executed along with Bombassi. They were hanging upside down together if you look at the pictures of the time. But
they got carried through their dead body got carried through the streets so that the people just ripped him and his wife apart.
Yeah, exactly, and his mistress. And interestingly enough, Bombassi, who was this old communist, he even knew Lenin briefly. He was hanging right next to Mussolini. A lot of people don't realize that. But I think what happened was the Italian working class was so disgusted with Mussolini, especially communist workers that were involved with the partisans. Like, even if Mussolini was posturing as returning to his socialist roots and everything, they didn't believe it. They thought that he was just playing games. And so that didn't really help him in the end. He was hoping that it would ease tension amongst workers and the government, but it didn't help.
Yeah. Well, another little summary of just trying to isolate between the two is that there's obviously on the fascist side, there's a little bit more of like an egotistical tyrant kind of person, and he really wants his subjects to be the super soldier, the eugenic survival of the fittest, Darwinist super soldier that will never question the nation and will soldier on. Whereas, like, if you look at maybe the communist side now, I don't want to use like the Stalinist view, like the more traditional view. There's a bit more of an accepting society, and also there's definitely an anti-racism thing going on as well with communist society, where there isn't necessarily a branch of like survival of the fittest, but more of an accepting kind of thing going on, or like everyone is equal.
Yeah, exactly. And I think what you're highlighting there is that fascism, as I said, it adheres to this social Darwinism, where they believe that human beings are in a perpetual struggle with one another, and the nation is the unit that is best situated to assert the people's place in the global struggle. So they're interested in expanding their territory and their people, because they think that we're locked in this eternal struggle with each other. Communists, however, believe in the principle of, it's not even a principle, just the fact of mutual aid amongst all living organisms, that we, just as we can be competitive, we can also be cooperative, and that when it comes to especially geopolitical arrangements, functioning off of a cooperative ethos is always preferable to a competitive one, because people aren't needlessly dying over these asinine theories.
Yep.
And honestly, that's a huge distinction between, even most liberal capitalists don't believe in this social Darwinist struggle. The fascists were unique in that sense. I mean, there was
that. I think that's where the hatred is between the two sections.
Yeah.
Essentially, there's a lot of similarities in the hate of the powers and the corporatist state and stuff like that. But when you isolate it to the super soldier versus the all accepting unit, then that's where the conflict arises.
Yeah. I mean, the fascists adhere to a reactionary nationalism, and communists throughout history have espoused internationalism. And I also do as well. And when I say internationalism, I don't want it to be confused for bourgeois globalism or cosmopolitanism. Internationalism simply means that we regard other populations as fellow human beings, and we don't seek to oppress or exploit them. We view them as, people whom we should cooperate with for the future. That's the main distinction. But also economically, I should emphasize that capitalists were adamant, or not cap, fascists were adamant about the necessity of class distinctions. They weren't always consistent. Like I said, eventually Mussolini started to return to his socialist roots, but fascism proper has always regarded the existence of economic classes as inevitable and the institution of private property as defensible, even though they don't adhere to the same rigid property regime as capitalists do.
Yep.
They still nonetheless insist upon the existence of private ownership of means of production. Because it stems from their paternalistic idea, especially in Germany, of the Führer principle. They view all things hierarchical, that hierarchy is the most conducive to success and efficiency. Communism, in their opinion, where we have horizontal social relations, democratic consent, they just think that that's chaotic and infeasible. It's like an a priori assumption.
Yeah, I have my reservations about hierarchy as well. Just another little footnote. Churchill went a little bit fascist as well during the Second World War because he created a unification of the government, all working for the national interests. So sometimes, really, when countries are at war, they turn into machines of fascism, don't they?
They do. I mean, you could see it in the United States with Roosevelt during the Second World War. The war economy is always somewhat fascistic because what you're doing is you're taking firms that are privately owned and then directing them towards certain aims that the state is tasked with coming up with. So, you know, and with the New Deal, that was part and parcel of it.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm going to give you a very difficult question, if you don't mind, Mike.
Not at all.
All right. Say we live in your most idolized communist society, and there is refugees which are, for whatever reason, there's no real borders or anything like that, but there's refugees which are strong proponents of the Islamic State and the Islamic way of life. How would your society work with that? Would it be accepting of that? Because, I mean, you could make some distinctions that Islamic State is a statism, it's a form of fascism itself as well, whereby they see themselves as better citizens than anybody else. Their religion almost dictates that. Right. So how would that work? I know that in the past, communism has sort of tried to wipe out religious preferences in the past. Not wipe out, but really has been not really like, there's not been a strong proponent of religion as well, but I'm just interested to see how your thoughts work with that, because that's it's quite a substantial phenomenon right now.
It is, yeah. I should specify that my views on immigration in general are at odds with most people who identify as a communist in the West today.
Yeah.
Now, in Eastern Europe and in South America, my views would be conventional. And in fact, if you look back historically, my views correspond with what most Marxists and at least Marxian socialists had espoused. But I am not a proponent of the free movement of labor or of mass refugee asylum, especially when we're dealing with incompatible problematic cultures like Islamic cultures. I think that it's naive to just assume that you can assimilate such a radically different population with Western values, let alone with socialist values.
Yeah.
It's an exercise in futility. I mean, it can work on a small scale. You had mentioned that previously. If you have a handful of migrants, whether they be refugees from Islamic countries or just, you know, people from their culturally distinct nations. If the population is small enough that's entering into the country, you can assimilate them. But when you're dealing with the size and the sort of culture that we're looking at with Islamic refugees, it's just an insane proposition. And as a communist, you and I have spoken about some of the principles I adhere to. One of them is self-management. So I believe that, and in fact, that's a fundamental principle. So I believe that people should have a right to participate in decisions to the degree they're affected by them. Now, when we're dealing with population transfers like refugees, that affects wherever these refugees end up coming to. So let's say that the United States is a communist commonwealth. Every citizen would have the right to vote as to whether or not we're permitting these people into our territory. There would be vigorous debate, I'm sure, as to whether or not it should be done. But I believe that whatever the outcome of that decision was would be justifiable. Just speaking for myself, I think that that's problematic. I think that bringing in people from these cultures, and I don't say this to, you know, minimize their humanity or anything like that. I'm just saying that the risk associated with bringing them in is not worth it. I mean, we are already seeing the outcome of that in Europe and the United States right now. I think that a better alternative would be assisting them in their own countries to sort of stabilize the situation there. I mean, the West is largely responsible for this crisis in the first place with all of our intervention in the Middle East. So we do have some responsibility, at least our governments.
Yeah.
But the way to resolve it isn't to bring all of the refugees into Western nations. The way to resolve it is to help them in their countries sort out the mess that we precipitated.
Absolutely. Okay, so there's a couple of things come into mind here. So, and one of the main things is that you can't have a community thinking that all, like, the proletariat is all second-class citizens, can you?
No, you cannot.
No, so that's probably the fundamental thing that's going wrong there, I'd imagine.
Yeah, exactly.
I forwarded on you a little video on InfoWars, which is always interesting from their perspective, because I don't necessarily even though they do look like freedom fighters and they're part of the libertarian sort of faction, they look very powerful, and they actually are representative of the mainstream government now. So even though they look like the freedom fighters and all that kind of stuff, you're almost like a state's mouthpiece, but you're camouflaged in looking like a freedom fighter at the same time. When it comes to the episodes that we've had with each other, one of the things that comes out is the similarities that we share. And this video encapsulated it, because there was this guy who came on, he was in a protest march. He had like the red star and some black clothing on. And he looked like he was going to just mouth off to the InfoWars presenter a load of jargon and look all foolish. But he was very astute. Everyone on the forum said, this guy's smart. He just literally had all his arguments already prepared. He must be politically connected or something like that, because you wouldn't be that good just being some general guy off the street. Yeah, this guy just twisted it on its head. He was pro-gun. He was really quite positive about capitalism. He says, yeah, capitalism is really an apparatus. It was a step for society, but there is a requirement to move on from capitalism. And I would agree with him. I'm sure you agree with him as well. But there was some distinctions that you found with what he said. I'll put a link to this video as well below, but I was just quite fascinated with your observations there. Like, you was very favorable for him, but then you just said there's some certain distinctions that we need to make out first.
Yeah. In terms of the contemporary left and the sort of people that one encounters, he is definitely the sort of a communist you would want involved in an organization if you were, say, you were forming one. Those are the kind of people you'd like, someone that's intelligent, disciplined, and knows how to convey his thoughts to opponents. It was interesting because, as you said, the InfoWars, they're so accustomed to interviewing just empty-headed buffoons at these protests, whether they be liberals or people that are posturing as socialists. You know, they're the worst of the worst, and it's not hard to come across them because the left is in such a dismal state right now, as I always emphasize. But this guy...
They don't know who they are, do they?
No, they don't. I mean, they don't understand what it is they claim to believe in. First of all, they don't understand communist theory. They don't understand basic economics. And their values are fundamentally at odds with communist values most of the time.
Yeah.
These people support speech censorship. They oppose the right to bear arms. All of these things that were pretty solid in the history of socialism, they've abandoned. I don't regard them as fellow travelers, in other words. This individual I do, but when he was discussing socialism and how we would achieve that mode of production. I took exception with a little bit. For instance, he seems to be a Leninist. He was defending vanguardist theory and Maoist China, and he had brought up the situation of state socialism.
Sorry,
I'm sorry. Go.
Could you just give me a quick summary of what Leninism is?
Leninism, in short, was the political theory that Vladimir Lenin had established prior to the Bolshevik Revolution. And during his tenure as the Soviet leader, he tried to follow those principles. Now, Leninism, it's a geopolitical theory. It's a theory of the national question, and it's first and foremost a theory of revolution. So Marx famously did not write a lot about communism in his lifetime, nor did Engels. They just wrote scattered pieces here and there, and they didn't write a whole lot about how a revolution would be achieved. Lenin felt that he had something to contribute towards that theory. And Lenin's theory of revolution centers around a vanguard of workers in possession of the most correct line in terms of class consciousness and how to proceed. So there's an asymmetry between where workers stand at any given moment. Whereas I, someone who studies Marxism and political economy, I have a sense of class consciousness that's far more heightened than another worker who's vaguely interested in socialism, and he has more of a conscious socialist consciousness vis-a-vis a worker that's never thought about politics. So there's always going to be an asymmetry of where people stand at any given moment. But Lenin believed that with a vanguard, a small elite, you could essentially topple the ruling regime with a coterie of similarly minded workers. And then you could institute communism almost by fiat. So once they got
Is this what he was mentioning about building a people's hospital, building a people's PlayStation?
That's a little different. And it was interesting because he claims that the Bolsheviks were involved in this kind of work. And they were to a limited extent, but not nearly as much as, say, the Italian Socialist Party had been after the First World War. He was talking about dual power and counter institutions. So you would have existing parallel to standard bourgeois institutions. You'd have institutions that were run by and for the working class. So you would have regular stores, you'd have hospitals, you would have educational institutions. And I agree with that. I think dual power is indispensable. Leninism is somewhat distinct from that, however, because leaving that aside, it's a theory of how you take state power. And as a council communist, I believe that the correct institution is going to be workers' councils, that self-governing workers' councils that are federated across national boundaries are going to be the means by which power is ultimately achieved. Leninists believe more in this insurrectionary notion of a vanguard of workers taking the reins of power and then establishing a socialist society thereafter. I disagree with that, not just as a practical matter, because I don't think that that model is feasible with the way the state has developed in capitalist countries, but also just as a matter of principle, I disagree. I think it's going to be more of a mass movement that's organized around these councils that are going to germinate the values that we want to see in the seceding mode of production. So I disagreed with him there, but I feel like there's an honest debate to be had with him on that question.
Yeah,
I think overall, however, our views parallel quite closely, especially when it comes to civil liberties.
Yeah, I don't know if you've got any the socialist or the communist movement are not that connected. Do you think you'll be able to find him somehow, or do you think too?
I had for a little while been looking at one of the organizations he said he was involved in, which is the Socialist Rifle Association.
Okay. So, and he's from Long Island as well.
Yeah, so I'm pretty sure that could narrow down the parameters for searching. And if I should find his information, I can forward it to you.
We'll try and have him on as well, because more the merrier, I guess.
Yeah.
And then also, what was the thing I'm trying to say is, for my understanding, is it the fact that because he creates these people's hospitals, these people's things, that there's too much of a too much power that's isolated in these units of providing good living standards? So this massive production society, this massive hospital society, is that too much for a council communist to take? Is that, am I correct in saying that, or is
it? It depends entirely on how those institutions are organized. Now, one of the principles of Leninism is democratic centralism, and what that means is that within the vanguard that's leading the revolution, there's a cadre of men, and those men debate what to do at any given situation amongst themselves. And then whatever they decide upon democratically is then adhered to by the entire movement that they're charged of. So it's a lot of power rested amongst a few people. As a libertarian communist, I don't believe in that. I think it needs to be more bottom up as opposed to top down. I think that the people, the workers that are involved in these institutions, whether they're running them or they're getting services by them, all deserve to play a role in deciding how those institutions function.
So, unfortunately, that's where the dialogue ends. My thanks goes out to Michael for his continued contribution as a guest to this show. Please stay tuned for further episodes, and hopefully we'll get that debate out to you shortly.